In terms of eschatology, proponents of free market capitalism tend to do two things. Following Francis Fukuyama, some proclaim that we have, in fact, reached the end of history. By this, they mean that with the emergence of capitalism, history has reached its telos. Everything has been leading to this state of affairs, and we have reached the pinnacle of human creativity. The other thing they do is claim that what we have is not actually capitalism. Instead, we have some form of interventionist capitalism where the market remains restricted, where consumers are not fully free. The first of these two moves is obviously incompatible with the eschatological vision of the New Testament. Our tradition certainly affirms that the telos of history has broken into the present, but it does not say that all has been reconciled and redeemed, and it clearly proclaims that any work of merely human creativity pales in comparison to the reign of God. The second position often stated by free marketeers is quite understandable. It is simply the outgrowth of the capitalist soteriology. Promises were made in ages past by our capitalist forefathers, and we've devoted ourselves to the via capitale. And yet the reality of beatitude remains in the future. As theologian Daniel Bell has pointed out, this false eschatology is particularly pernicious among Christian advocates of capitalism, who found their advocacy on the problematic eschatological claim that, in effect, capitalism is the best we can expect in this time between the times. Said differently, Christian defenses of capitalism hinge upon releasing the eschatological tension between the already and the not yet by means of emptying the already of any immediate material content, such as the social, political, and economic, with the result that we are left to ponder the capitalist status quo as the lesser evil, as the best we can expect until at some future point God decides to act. In the Christian capitalist theology, there is but one age, even as we look forward to the age to come. There is no overlapping, no transformation or redemption here and now, beyond the comfort offered to the rich that they will be forgiven, and the consolation offered to the impoverished that in the next age things will be different. In this barren space where we are locked in competition and struggle for scarce resources that God has apparently hidden like a cosmic Easter bunny so that we might be prodded from lethargy to creativity, the best we can hope for is to find shelter in the shade provided by market mechanisms, dancing in the heavens, doing their work. But here again is the juxtaposition. No humanly ordered economic vision will rectify this broken world. The reign of God is not something we build from the top. It is not anything we can control or finalize with our own ingenuity. We participate in its appearance only from below, in practices of cruciformity, gift, advocacy for the weak. Perhaps we should say that, in the end, it is only something we receive. Following Daniel Bell again, we should point out that the question is not so much what can we do or what economic system is most compatible with our ecclesial vocation, but rather what is God doing in the world and how can I participate in it? What shape does God's action take in Jesus? And how can we map our own lives onto the trajectory of his, which, it's important to add, led outside the city gates? Christian advocacy of capitalism represents a failure of discipleship imagination, a failure to discern in the God-given cruciform practices of our tradition a radically alternative economic modality that, when practiced, bears witness to the fleeting nature of the present evil age with all of its inequity. Technology of fracture. Because capitalism offers another vision of the world than does a Christological reading of the Bible, it also forms us and the world differently than does the biblical narrative. As the people of the book, ours is a story of restoration, flourishing, and the total recovery of creatureliness through the Spirit of God. I'll say more about how our story is restorative and generates resurrection in a moment, but first let's ask the question, in what way does capitalism shape us? How does it school our imagination and will? How does it come to bear upon the earth? By technology of fracture, I want to suggest that market capitalism's mechanics form us, as well as the non-human creation, in ways that are adversarial to God's desire for us. By technology, I mean to draw on notions of technique and yoke and school all at the same time. It functions as a training mechanism. And by fracture, I mean to suggest fissure, division, separation, alienation, and so on. We could also call it a technology of dysfunction, or a denaturing technology, in that it erodes our creaturely integrity. In other words, just as you will inevitably resemble that which you worship, Mammon's deadly grin dehumanizes us. The best example I can give of this is that capitalism trains us in the practice of objectification, such that we become severed from each other and our environments. We see forests in terms of board feet. We speak of investing in friendship. William Kavanaugh points out that capitalism has a tendency to reduce everything, both the material and the spiritual, to a commodity able to be exchanged. Things that no other culture ever thought could be bought or sold. Water, genetic codes, names, human blood, the rights to emit pollutants into the air are now routinely offered on the market. The recent story of the Nebraska man who auctioned off advertising space on his forehead is only the latest example of the commodification of everything. This story is not so much a lesson about greed as a statement about the extent to which we are able to become detached from even those things like our foreheads, to which we are most obviously attached. We stand back from our bodies, faiths, vocations. Our very identity is something to be tried on, chosen, bought, sold, and discarded at will. I would go as far as to say that capitalism is perhaps the mechanism by which we have achieved the most rapid, massive, and totalizing destruction of natural habitats the world over. Buying, selling, and trading things that should only be considered as owned by God is perhaps the single clearest explanation for bringing us all to the edge of ecocide, which is where we've been living for some time now, if you haven't been paying attention. The biblical tradition, however, educates our imaginations and forms our faculties of desire and will in an entirely different manner. I'll quote Kavanaugh extensively to show what I mean. He writes, "Created things are good because they participate in the goodness of their creator. They contain vestiges of the creator in them, vestiges that ought to lead us beyond the things themselves to the source of their being. In other words, they are sacramental. In this spiritual universe, there is no such thing as an isolated commodity confronting an isolated individual. All created things sing and dance and shout of the glory of God. People and things are united in one great web of being, flowing from and returning to their creator. Our dissatisfaction with things does not lead us endlessly on to the next thing, but to our true end in God. The Christian view elevates the dignity of things by seeing them as participating in the being of God, but simultaneously causes us to look through and beyond things to their creator. Participation in this great web of created being informs the way that Christians view production. Work is not simply a means to gaining money so that we may consume. Work establishes an intimacy with God's creation so that we become, as Pope John Paul II reminds us, co-creators with God in our work. Participation in God also informs how we view one another. Human persons are not only connected to things but to other persons. We are all made in the image of God and all made to participate in the body of Christ. Such is our close connection that we share the same sufferings and the same joys, as is said in 1 Corinthians 12. It is as impossible to ignore sweatshop labor as it is to ignore pain in our own bodies. In the Christian view, we do not stand apart from the rest of creation as individuals, appropriating, consuming, and discarding. We are rather consumed, as it were, by something larger than us. When we consume the body of Christ at the Lord's table, we are in fact consumed by the larger body, the church. Augustine hears Christ's voice say, "Grow and you will feed on me, and you will not change me into you like the act of consumption. You will not change me into you like the food your flesh eats, but you will be changed into me." At the communion table, the act of consumption is turned inside out, such that in eating we become food for others. True consumption, in the Christian understanding, is thus a kind of self-emptying, a decentering of the self into a larger web of participation. Thus, Jesus connects the abundant life in John 10:10 to laying down one's life in 10 verse 11. True abundance is never realized by the competition of insatiable desires for scarce goods. It is realized by emptying the small self into the larger reality of God's superabundant life. What time are we at?
15 minutes.
15 minutes left?
15, yeah.
Or I just went 15. That's it? How much time do I have left?
You have 15 minutes left.
That's perfect.
Yeah. Or as much as you want to
pay. Who's on first? I have a lot more, so I'm going to have to scale it down. Capitalism as crypto-fascism. It's the most... I should have went first with that one so we got it all in so that we could actually know what the heck I mean by that. The free enterprise rhetoric is front-loaded with the language of freedom. At its most basic, what the capitalist means by freedom is the absence of interference from others in decisions, particularly the state. It is then said that when state power, or any other power for that matter, is removed, this market is then uninhibited by external interference. I just think that that is just complete crap. Like, I feel like it's totally interfered. I'm going to just depart from what I've written because it's too long. But I think of this town, for example, as a victim of really terrible historic racialization. And so if your parents were the first freed slaves, then they simply do not have the same access to they don't have the same amount of choices. They don't have the same access to goods and resources, even skill sets, as, you know, for example, my grandfather and great-grandfather. There is a force at work, even after the state decides to get out of the way or something, or even to get in the way and say, these people are just as much, they're free to operate within society. There's still another force at work long after the state's just not even in the picture anymore. And we can't find an institution that we can like wrap our fingers around and say, this force is influencing economics and I can grab it right here and I can fix it, either by deconstructing it or getting somebody to change it from within or something like that. None of that works. And so racism, I think, the fact that we live in a racialized society is an example of how today we simply don't exist in some sort of free space, even if the state were to withdraw from our economic transactions. You know, a couple of years ago, I got into a car accident where I lost almost all my front teeth, and my grandmother hooked me up with some money to get some new teeth. And we were living in College Hill, and like, one out of every three people that I was meeting in that neighborhood didn't have the teeth that I was missing. You know, they also didn't have them. But it just so happened that I had a grandmother, had some money who could help me get those teeth, and they simply didn't.